Well, welcome to Off the Clock come this holiday week. Eric and for Chris, good
Mr.
to Schauble, see you.
Mr. Schauble taking some time off.
Yeah, you know? He doesn't do it often, but when he does, it's deserved.
Yes. He needs it.
Yeah.
And he didn't
wound
text
a little
me
tight.
Today either, so I don't know what's going on.
I know, I didn't hear from him either. It's very rare, very, very rare.
He'll text you on his day off. Yeah.
All hours of the day.
He's always
it's what we love about him. Yeah. It's true. All right, here's what's on tap for our show today. It is Travel Tuesday, and what's a better way than a great giveaway? How you can fly for free on board Velo Airlines. That's coming up in just a bit.
Also, how do you handle holiday dinner with the family with a set of rules and regulations? The viral Reddit post that has people divided.
I'm so happy. I know we'll get to this, but boy, there's people that really go through some holiday hassles.
Big time.
Yeah. Thank goodness. Don't deal with that. Shame, where you could soon be called out for this egregious action at the airport. We'll talk about that in just a bit.
All right, we start with this, a new travel trend, but would you do it? It is called extreme day tripping. So what classifies as extreme? Well, basically taking a flight out of state or across the country just to enjoy a few hours in a different destination before heading back. There is a Facebook group with 250,000 people who dedicate their days off to extreme day tripping. For example, a man booked himself a last minute round trip flight from New York to Miami because he felt like a beach day. He left New York at 7 a.m., got home at 11 p.m. He only packed a backpack, spent his time in the beach in Miami. Why not? Especially if there's a great travel deal happening. And
I mean, probably 24, too.
Yeah.
You know, young.
Kind of.
Adventurous.
Yeah. I see it as like a staycation kind of vibe.
I flew up on Saturday for the Cal-Stanford game.
There you go.
You fly to Oakland. It's a one-hour flight. No big deal. Go to the game. No checked luggage, no handbag, nothing.
It's the best.
You know?
And just a wallet and a phone.
Yeah, that's it.
Just and you did not stay overnight.
Did not stay overnight.
Which, by the way,
in the morning,
I
came back
completely get that because that would have tacked on, what, how much more to stay there for the night?
A few hundred.
And for what, right?
There's no reason.
Yeah.
Just to sleep and get up and go back to the airport.
Yeah, in a bed that's not your own.
Yeah. But it was great. It was fantastic. I see the value of doing the day trip. If the airlines are convenient, you know, if it's a nonstop flight, if it's maybe an hour or two at the most.
If you're in the same time zone.
Yeah.
That helps. Exactly.
Distance makes a big
difference.
Sure. Yeah.
I don't think I'd ever do it at LAX, though, honestly.
Yeah, it's just too much time.
Yeah.
Eric did
but
it,
I'll
though.
I'll tell you what.
Did you go to LAX?
Yes. And the early flight is if you get on a 6:25 flight out of LAX.
It's true.
It's not bad.
No.
Okay. I don't know. I think it just gives me anxiety of like, where do you park? Do you park in there or do you go to like the parking spot or something like that?
Parking spot usually, or you know, you can Uber or something like that. No? She's shaking her head and shivers.
Yeah, but if you're going for one day, I mean, parking does suck at LAX just from the standpoint. It's expensive, you know, even for 24-hour parking. But I mean, you kind of factor that into
you
the trip.
You can also Uber. I mean, listen, there's ways
closer.
To do this.
Anyway, the plane was packed with people who were doing the same thing.
Yeah.
So there you go.
I support it.
Yeah. All right, speaking of travel, what is something you cannot stand while waiting to catch your flight? If it's line cutters, well, get ready, because they soon could feel the shame that they deserve. Line cutters, yes. On American Airlines, they're trying this now. After the carrier announced it will expand its use of the new tech that calls out line cutters. American Airlines gave the technology a test run at airports in Arizona and New Mexico. When the gate agent scans a passenger's ticket, it will sound an alarm if a passenger got into a boarding group they're not supposed to be in. That passenger is then sent back to a seat to wait for their proper group number. All right, after positive feedback, American says it will expand the system to 100 airports across the country by Thanksgiving.
I mean, I've had this happen before accidentally. So I don't feel.
Oh sure, accidentally.
No, it actually has been. Like you go to the bathroom and then you think one group is boarding and it's not the right. You know, you think it's your group. I'm not a line cutter in that way. But I guess my point is it went up and it's just like, oh, it's not your time. I'm like, okay. Like I actually didn't feel like extreme embarrassment. It was an honest mistake and I went back and so I think we're all envisioning sirens going off and being like, cutter, cutter.
You have to wear a siren.
Yes,
on your
head. Exactly. I cut the line.
Shame.
Exactly. Everybody go. I don't feel like it's going to be that. I think it's just the, you know, it's not
First
your turn
First of all, I got two
and
things.
And accidents happen.
First of all, why do you want to be like the first person on the plane. I want to be the last person.
I'll tell
on
you
the plane.
Why.
Only to get your luggage.
Well,
in
Southwest.
The
exactly.
That's the only one.
It's all
and Southwest.
About
yeah.
the luggage. The
Southwest.
Overhead
but other
space.
Other than that, if you're not dealing with overhead space, you know, if you don't need it mm-hmm. for whatever reason, I mean, mm-hmm. honestly, I want to be the last person on the plane.
For me, it's all about the overhead space.
Because you're in that
though.
Sardine can for a defined amount of time.
Yeah.
You don't want to be there any longer than you have to be, right?
Depends and on the airlines where you're at and all that
But the
that
second
stuff.
Thing about the line cutters is what, like, if you believe in the system that airlines have, mm-hmm. boarding group number 5 versus boarding group number 2, like, they have a system where they believe it's the most efficient way to board the aircraft.
I have noticed, though, it's not consistent. Mm-hmm. Meaning, I want to say, like, the last couple times I've flown United, and mm-hmm. It, there's no rhyme or reason for this flight versus the next flight.
Really?
I think there is, Megan.
There was not in my last two flights. It could be depending on the type of plane. But there was not in my last two, my coming and my going, there was no, it didn't make sense to me.
I also think, and I could be incorrect, because I flew United and I had boarding group 2 and my friends that I was with had boarding group 4 and they were like, how could that be? Because you got your ticket this last week and we've had it for 2 months and I had a window seat. So I think for United, if you're a window seat, they'll put you in earlier. That way, as they fill in, people yes. aren't like, get yeah. out, you know, yeah. I need to get past. Right. And then people stand up, get in the aisle. So I do think that has, to your point, I think there is a method to the madness. I also think, too, I think this really is just for the agents to not have that awkward, and some of them yeah. don't care. They're like, you know, they'll be like,
they
you're in the wrong group. You know, they're almost,
they
kind of take pleasure in it. But I think there's
just
others.
Don't feel like
they don't
it's
want
that.
That
big of a deal.
Well, you don't
I
think
mean,
what?
I don't think it's that big of a deal if it's an accident and they're like, no, you're
yeah,
right
but,
now.
But
your
see, Megan, you're nice, and
next.
Most people aren't doing accidents. I'm just being honest, especially in the Southwest. I mean,
Southwest
the people that try
like,
to, there's people
yeah.
that try
Southwest
to get
is
in the A group.
Totally the honor system, you know, the numbers are there, and no, I don't think they really
Well, now
check.
They scan, no, they do now.
They
I
do.
Mean, it scans, and they'll yeah. tell you, hey, you're in the wrong
but
boarding
they
group,
don't.
And you have to go back, or what, and this is why I think Southwest is changing a lot of the rules. With Southwest, you can get early bird, so you can get it for $20, $15,
right.
bucks,
yeah.
whatever it is. So if you're traveling with someone, what people will try to do is they'll buy one early bird, and then they'll try
Sneak
to have
the other person.
Somebody else come with them, and then that person is like, I'm sorry, you're in A group, but you're in B group, or whatever. And I think they want to cut down that interaction and that uncomfortable feeling for the people up there. Otherwise, it's like a buzzer, and it's like, oh, you know, whether it was a mistake or not, it's like, oh, sorry, you're in B. And then it's also those people that know what they're trying to do or, oh, you know what, my friend's up there. I was got, you know, whatever. Those people aren't going to even chance it anymore.
It's like getting into the club.
Yeah.
It's like I will literally, if I see somebody with a ticket that's not where they belong, I'd be like, this is, you don't belong here. Sorry, I've been waiting here. I sat there with my finger on the trigger trying to get this spot.
Oh, that's
and
funny.
You are not here. Go away. Sorry.
Yeah, you see that. I you know what? I think it.
And then that person accidentally spills their Coke on you.
You know what? They're just never going to sit next to me, so it doesn't even matter. They'll see my face, and they'll be like, nope. Yep.
Well, people will be traveling for Thanksgiving. It is that time of year as family gathers around the Thanksgiving table and is first handed a code of conduct.
Before they sit down to eat, yeah. Each person is handed a code of conduct. Is that an idea that's worth talking about? I don't know.
A post has gone viral on Reddit, and of course, the internet is split. The user says that she always hosted Thanksgiving dinner, and it gets a little messy sometimes, but this year, her sister sent a code of conduct letter to everyone coming to dinner, and she is demanding that they sign it before they arrive. Conditions include no political conversations whatsoever, no overlapping conversations at the dinner table. She was also demanding a smart, casual dress code, so all family photos are respectable. It led to a debate about whether there should be any rules to family gatherings. Should there be them, or do you just embrace the potential chaos?
I think rule number one, do not spill red wine on the white carpeting.
Mm. Nope.
Did you do that?
No.
Do you have white carpeting?
We do.
Oh my God.
Do you have carpeting
scary.
Or white
not,
rug?
Not, we have it in the bedroom.
Oh,
but,
that's
so we're
that's
not drinking
risky.
Red wine
that's
in the bedroom.
Risky.
Yeah.
Yeah, kind of is.
Very
my wife
risky.
Likes, she likes everything white. White, that's, you know, couches yeah. and white, you know, it's.
Well, you got to be at attention the entire time.
Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
You can't bring a piece of cake from the dinner, you know, after dinner dessert over to the couch.
Right.
You got to eat at the dinner table.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. I think listen, if you've had a really, if last year was really bad and, you know, Cousin Earl was fighting with Aunt Martha and it caused a big drama, and then somebody sends out a playful, like, hey, let's try to do this a little nicer this year, I don't have a problem with that. I just, listen, to each their own. If you want, it's
your
house.
Yeah, but it is ridiculous.
It is ridiculous, but then don't go. I guess that's my point. I'm always just like, why do we care?
I think it's sad that somebody would have to put out a list.
Yeah.
It is sad.
I mean, when I was a child, and I don't mean to date myself, people didn't bring up their political opinions as much.
Yeah, people can't help themselves these days, though. You know,
I mean, and I remember going at Thanksgiving recently, somebody started doing that. And I said, not in my house. Stop
See?
Now.
See?
I said, we're not going to have this discussion here. This is Thanksgiving. It's not happening.
This was your code of conduct.
Well, was this a family member or
a
guest?
It was a code of, it was a yeah. family member.
Yeah.
You know,
imagine Eric reprimanding you. I'd be like, okay.
But I just wanted
but
it to
But I
be...
think that's much different and acceptable, and I don't have a problem with that as opposed to, you know, a code of conduct.
Right.
I mean, that seems a little bit overboard, but I think it's fine. I think we all, I shouldn't speak for anyone, but typically in a family, if you have a large enough family, there's always kind of somebody you gotta worry about.
Yep,
like maybe they
one.
Drink too much or say too much. And I know the nuances that we do in our family. It's usually somebody might go up to and say, maybe it's whatever, I don't want to even put it. You might say, hey, listen, you know what, let's just have a good time.
Take it
tell
down a notch.
So-and-so, let's not bring that up. Let's just have a good time. You know, I think those conversations exist when you kind of have a heads up. Somebody might be the one that's just kind of pushing
troublemaker.
The troublemaker. And usually you might do something to kind of head it off at the pass. But that's a lot of work right there. And asking for people, you know, you would like to think people know how to dress accordingly to Thanksgiving meal.
I mean, here's the deal. This is coming from
different.
Somewhere. I guess that's my point. I just never know. I feel like people's reality, we can't even imagine them sometimes.
That's
Do you know
true.
What I mean? Like, mm-hmm. imagine last year, you know, at Aunt Ann's and Uncle Fred's house, there was a big fist fight that broke out, and
right.
someone showed up naked. And then, you know, there's 5-year-old twins who saw it and are now traumatized by it. I mean, we just don't
That's
know.
True.
Do you know what I'm saying? So I always feel like it's like, if the code of conduct is your situation,
yeah.
go ahead. And by the way, we don't have to show up there. You don't have to go. I think that's the other. And I guess things get political with families and that sort of thing.
But overall, it's you know, a great holiday. I mean,
yes,
it's the greatest
it's the best.
Holiday.
It is. I mean, lots of good
sit
food.
Around and,
yes.
And you know, there's wonderful conversation.
Unbutton your pants.
There is always somebody.
There's always somebody. It's like, oh boy, this turkey's great. Yeah, it's really expensive this year. Well, you know, if you would have voted this way, you know what I mean. It's just somebody who's got to throw in something, right? It just
well,
never
you don't
ends.
Pour them enough wine. Like keep the wine away from them.
Yeah.
Certain people need to be cut off.
Yeah.
They're the ones that get the code of conduct. You don't have to do it to everybody. Just that 1-2 people that, you know, are a problem.
And if you're out there and you have a big family gathering and you don't have anyone in the family like that, that's because you are the one person. That's what I always say. You
keep
just
that
don't
in mind.
It. Keep it in mind. Time for our question of the day. Here it is. What is one of your Thanksgiving traditions? Eric, I'm going to start with you.
We barbecue a turkey.
Every year?
Yeah,
you
every
do
year.
It. Are you
I
the
do.
One in charge?
I'm doing it. We also cook what we call a backup turkey, which we've never really needed, but we do it anyway.
Ooh, that's good. Then you have leftovers.
Oh, that's smart.
Yeah. So one is oven roasted and the other one's in the barbecue. The barbecue turkey tastes really good.
But the backup turkey, is it because did it stem
because
from
my
a
wife
not
has
trusting?
No faith. Yes.
Okay, so not
no
just in the barbecue.
But it's great. I mean, you use mesquite chips. And you get a really smoky flavor to the turkey, which is really nice.
Yeah, very nice.
It is, you know, everybody, you put a kind of a special sauce on the outside of it at the very end, and you use, it's beer butt turkey. So you use a half can of beer, and supposedly when the turkey gets hot enough, the beer is boiling on the inside of the turkey in the can, and adding that moisture to the inside.
Yeah, it makes sense.
Well, you put the beer can in there?
Yes. You cut off the top of the beer can.
Okay.
And you can put like herbs and spices in the beer.
Yeah.
So that you get like the whole aroma.
Yeah.
You know?
Ooh. That's fantastic.
You need 11 herbs and spices to really do it just right.
I would just say familiar recipes, although this year for the first time we're going out to eat.
Right.
Which,
well, that saves a lot of stress.
You know what? It is. It's saving stress. We just don't want to even deal with it this year, so we've decided to go out. So it's breaking tradition, but normally I would say, you know, the same recipes. You want the same one that grandma's made for many, many years and that sort of thing. And honestly, my Thanksgiving tradition has been working. Right. I work every Thanksgiving. You work every Thanksgiving.
I do.
Chris
like
was
work.
Supposed to work this Thanksgiving, but he kind of last minute pulled out, right. which I support, by the way.
I think he's got something that he had to do.
Yeah. So. No. He deserves it, okay. by the way. And yeah. it's not. It's an easy day
yes.
to work.
It
by
is
the way.
An easy day.
Yeah. Yeah. But I'd say just the same recipes usually. But yeah. see, I'm breaking it, so it's not really a tradition. We're breaking it this year.
Well,
going out.
Why not?
Keep it easy.
Well, I have a Thanksgiving tradition. I never work on Thanksgiving.
I know,
so I plan
that's
on
yours.
Keeping that Thanksgiving tradition. I think oftentimes it's recipes that, you know, either my mother or my mother-in-law made. Mm-hmm. That is just kind of a staple.
Uh-huh.
But the other one is we like to play a game. We do it on even Christmas Eve when we get together. We like to play a game after Thanksgiving. We usually play a game called Left, Right, Center. I don't know if you're the little mm-hmm. dice game. And so, yeah, we like to just do one. You know,
group
game.
Activity.
Yeah, just to something
sure.
that's real fun. Because yeah, it's a lot fun. Of football, a lot of sitting around eating, drinking, but it's the one, we have dinner and everything, and then we play it, and there's betting involved. Everyone puts in a dollar. So, you know, somebody's going to walk home with $20.
That's
it's just
nice.
Fun. We just laugh.
Yeah.
And
do you,
it's just a cool
do you have an
game.
Early Thanksgiving, or do you go for the later?
It's usually about midday. Like, usually it's more like a 2 o'clock uh-huh. thing. Eat, like, 3 or 4. It might be 1 o'clock, but generally it's kind of, like, in between lunch dinner time.
Linner uh-huh. is what we
yeah.
call it.
Mm-hmm. Do it linner. But it's gotten a little bit more difficult because now that my sisters, and their kids, and then now they have in-laws, so it's always that kind of finessing a time to where they can spend time with their family.
Right.
In-laws and things like that. Yeah. So it's kind of gravitated a little bit later.
Yeah.
I get it.
So anyway, how about you, Kara?
Mine have kind of changed. I think my favorite tradition was back when my grandma was still around and all the family would come and we'd just have this big huge Thanksgiving dinner, and it was like the traditional thing, and I got to see my aunt and my uncle, everybody from the East Coast and Florida, so that was lovely. I would give almost anything to have that again. Now we were going to Chicago to visit Chris's family since we don't really ever get to go back there. We're not doing that this year, the last 2 years, so now it's just having a Thanksgiving meal with the kids, just us. We yeah. get it, we order it from Marie Callender's. Last year we tried, what is that barbecue spot?
Lucille's?
Yes, we did Lucille's, we loved it, but we wanted to go back more to the traditional, because the kids, if it tastes a little bit not like what they're used to, they're not for it. Has that little bit of that smoky flavor, the turkey, mm-hmm. which is really good, but the kids were like, this isn't turkey. So anyway, so that's ours. It's small, but I'd
be
kill
fine.
To have all the family over,
yeah.
but when you're not from here, it's hard. Yeah. So, anyways, we'll
should
do our
we
viewers.
Answer Chris for Chris?
What
he's,
is his?
He's into the Popeyes chicken.
He does.
He's obsessed with that.
Really?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
yeah.
That he
yeah.
gets a
it is good.
Popeyes turkey. Yeah.
Yes.
He'll probably do it for Christmas. I
yeah.
Right.
That's
it makes
true.
It easier. Yeah. Over on Facebook, we'll start with Alan, being with family and friends. Oh, and the football. Cindy, family, and my green bean casserole. Susie, watch the Thanksgiving Day parade. Monty, mac and cheese, must be on the menu. David, again, food, parades, football games. Heather says, spend it at the river with my friends. It's my personal holiday to myself, away from family, going on 40 years now. On Thanksgiving morning, I make Pillsbury orange rolls and watch the Macy's Day Parade. That sounds lovely.
Yeah.
Kathy, feeding the guts of the butterball to the crows. Denise says, they say it's my yams and deviled eggs. We'll do X. Turkey Trot says, Tiana, we love her. She's always showing her run pictures. Karen, watching the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. Carol, bacon pineapple roll-ups.
Hmm.
And Fran says, having the family over for turducken. Instagram, Marissa Ortega, or Miss Ortega says, I watch I Love Lucy. It reminds me of a marathon that would air the day after Thanksgiving when I was a kid.
Oh, it used to be Twilight Zone on Thanksgiving,
yeah, we used to
too,
have that.
Here.
Yeah.
We didn't stop that long ago on KTLA doing that.
We used to have it.
They should bring
a few
it
years
back.
Ago.
Yeah. Nacho Chic says, our family sharing one thing that they're thankful for. Ross Stone says, we watched Christmas Vacation and Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. That's a great movie. Mary says, prepare the meal, enjoy it, and clean up afterwards. We have travel. And I actually like this one. We usually watch all the Friends episodes. I've done that. And Keith says he has his Thanksgiving in October.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Why not?
Thank you.
A lot of good stuff there. It all comes down to food, family,
friends.
Football, yeah. All that good
Fantastic
stuff.
Fantastic holiday.
Yeah.
Come on.
It really is. You know, as you get older, it's your favorite holiday because you get to eat, you get to watch football, you get to have drink, I mean, all that stuff. You know, Christmas is more for kids and obviously
pumpkin
celebrating
pie too,
the birth of Christ.
Oh, yeah.
But anyway, all right, still to come. How do you blow off steam? We have some popular options that people swear by and may not help at all, plus some tasty treats when we come back.
Sweat and blood went into this cake, and you will not leave this platform until you have consumed the entire confection. Entire confection. See you at lunch.
Forget the pie, let them eat cake. Today is National Cake Day. It celebrates the bundts, the sheets, the tiered, even the boxed variety, along with all flavors and designs. The Oxford English Dictionary traces the word cake to the 13th century, but it wasn't until the 19th century that it was used as a way to celebrate a birthday.
Do you know what that movie is? That's Matilda.
Ah, oh, Matilda.
Yep.
That was a cute movie.
It's one of my favorites.
Matilda. So we know what's going on Thursday, right?
Of course.
Yes.
Thanksgiving. So what better way to celebrate? Nice dessert.
With pies. I love it.
We want to thank our friends from Polly's Pies. Now, Eric, you were saying you don't have a Polly's Pies near you that you're aware of.
I mean, there could be, but I don't
know. I don't think
where
there is one near you.
Right.
I'm familiar with
talking about
because
the west side of L.A., yeah. Santa Monica, there's no Polly's Pies.
I grew up,
to my knowledge,
partially in Long Beach, and there was always a Polly's Pie down the street.
Yep.
When I was in junior high.
It was one in Orange,
it's
one
like
in Orlando. Yeah, I grew up with Polly's Pies, but they brought some great. We have an apple tart, we have pecan pie, pumpkin pie. This one right here is really interesting. Let me, I already forgot the name of it, Megan. I'm so sorry.
It's something with pumpkin.
It looks
in
half
it.
Pumpkin,
no,
half.
Yes, it's a pumpkin.
Crumbly.
Oh, where? See, this
Didn't
is.
Did you say maple?
It's a pumpkin maple crunch.
Ooh,
wow.
Classic pumpkin pie topped with a sweet crumbly topping made with brown sugar, Coach's oats, and cinnamon. I was interested in trying this one. I'm going to take a bite here, Megan. I'm going to
pass
around.
We'll take it. So here's my question. Do people have to order? I'm going to take it from the back.
Do it.
This is my favorite
Because you like the crust.
Because I'm obnoxious like that. Do people have to order their pies ahead of time? And I'm only taking one bite.
You know you, Megan.
Or are they already there for pickup?
Listen, so here's the deal with Polly's Pies. You can order online ahead of time. You can have them ready for pickup. You can pick them up tomorrow. You can pick them up Thursday. And, of course, even if you forget, maybe you wake up Thursday morning, you're like, oh, my gosh, we're going to Aunt Jean's, and we're supposed to bring over dessert. They will be open until 11 a.m. on Thanksgiving. So, obviously, first come, first serve, they will have extra pies that will be made. I'm sure they'll have an abundance of pumpkin pies. But the great thing about Polly's, they probably have 20 different varieties of pies. We're just showing some here. I love pecan pie, so the pecan pie. This is actually something different. That maple crunch to pumpkin.
That is outstanding.
And it basically is pumpkin with the maple stuff on top.
It's got them mixed together, and I wouldn't have thought that combination would be that great, but it works.
I am pleasantly really surprised with that. Could you imagine that? Heated up a little bit with some ice cream. Unbelievable.
Yeah.
1968, that's when Polly's Pie started. Has 13 locations throughout Southern California. As I mentioned, they're open until 11 o'clock on Thanksgiving, so you can stop in and pick one up.
But somebody said 1 p.m. I'm not sure, though, so don't quote me
Maybe
on that.
No, you know what? I did confirm it because I didn't want to make a mistake. It's 11 a.m.
Okay.
Of course, you can go online. You can purchase ahead of time and then pick them up. You can get them either Wednesday or Thursday morning. But some of the different ones that they have. We have the apple crisp, banana cream, banberry, chocolate silk.
Banana and berry.
Okay. Yeah.
All right.
Lemon meringue, you know, apple, cherry
I think
pies. They
have
it
some
all.
Sugar-free options.
They
too.
Do with Splenda. So there's a lot of different options. We want to thank our friends over at Polly's Pies since family owned too. So
also, you can get feasts there. You know how I'm a feast lover. You can get a feast there, a Thanksgiving feast. So that's one of the options.
Everything with all the fixins.
Yeah,
there you go.
As they
that's
like to say.
Thing to do.
Anyway, thanks to Polly's Pie. You ready for some finger looking good?
Yeah. I don't know about this.
Well, I don't know about this
this
either.
This is like, I have a problem with this.
Yeah, this is odd. Get ready to get licking this holiday season in the spirits of making things
finger
licking good.
Here.
Sorry.
I'm sorry.
I changed the read just to Henry so that he would read.
Yeah.
He'll read that. Yep. He will. Yep. And you knew it.
I'll be honest. I don't even know what I just read. Did I say something? No, anyway.
Get ready to get licking the song. I don't think I would have read that.
Listen, I think people are going to remember Megan's words out of today's show.
Oh.
Anyway, KFC launching Christmas wrapping paper that tastes like chicken. Don't they say everything tastes like chicken?
Yeah, pretty much.
I guess the paper does too. Tastes like KFC's original recipe chicken with a touch of cranberry sauce and other flavors. The paper cannot be eaten, but it can be licked. The lickable areas actually have a protective cover that needs to be removed before tasting.
Okay.
Of course, it's...
Because I was going to say, you're storing your gifts underneath the tree on the floor, and then people are picking up the packages and licking.
Oh, no, there's a protective covering.
Ooh. Okay.
But here's the deal. It's not available in the U.S., so don't get too excited.
It's only available in, like,
I think
Ireland.
The U.K. and Ireland. Uh-huh.
You know what is available here?
Yeah, yeah. Keep eating.
More of this
keep eating. Keep eating.
I'm hungry now.
All right.
I'm going to get it from the side.
Do it. The internet is gobbling up this viral one-pan Thanksgiving recipe, but it's leaving kind of a bad taste in many people's mouth. The clip posted by creator Kate Heiselman has nearly 8 million views. It shows her dumping her bird, all the cooked ingredients for her side dishes, in the same pan. People left comments like, how many people have you killed? Regardless of the naysayers, she says she's planning a one-pan ham for Christmas. It saves time with cooking, she says, and there's less dishes to wash. See, I always feel like this is just a way to get clicks and a way to get views, and she succeeded. So good for her. I don't feel like anyone's actually going to eat this. I don't know.
Every one of those sides has a different... length of time.
Right.
I mean, some of them are going to be quite well done.
Right, because when you cook, depending on the pound of the turkey, you could be cooking that turkey for 3 hours.
I know this is all lies. Does she show us the finished product?
I don't know.
What she's suggesting is that you remove the sides once they're cooked.
I don't know. I feel like it's lies. Lies, I tell you.
I agree with you, Megan.
Lies.
It's a scam.
It's a scam.
We fell for it.
We do. We fall for it. So I don't blame her.
Good for you.
She went viral. Exactly. All right. Still to come, a giveaway to help you get away. And it's Travel Tuesday, and we are helping you fly for free. Details on how to score some free tickets on board Avelo Airlines coming up. Are you a venter when you get angry? Do you feel that it just helps to get it out? Well, apparently it doesn't.
Okay.
I don't know. In fact, not only it may not reduce your stress intake, but instead it could make you angry. According to research from Ohio State University, it found that there is little improves anything.
Improvement.
What is it?
I don't know.
What are you trying to say?
There is little improve.
It doesn't improve anything.
Okay. Experts say other activities like working out, going for a run, smashing things in those trendy rage rooms won't help either because it just gets you hyped up. Instead, they say calming activities are best, like meditating, yoga, deep breathing, because they help diffuse the anger.
What about exercise?
Megan, this was brought to you by the Yoga Association because I think working out, physical, that definitely helps. You can't tell me that doesn't help. The act of physically venting and yelling and screaming, it may be in the moment, but then you deal with, boy, I was a jerk, shouldn't have done that, said things I didn't mean, hurt somebody I really care about.
Right. I think sometimes, too, if you're venting to somebody who's like, yeah, sometimes it can make things worse. Mm-hmm. You know, you both then start going, and another thing, and then you're like,
I'm going to go break up with that jerk.
Yeah. And then they kind of like feed off of each other.
You're like, wait a minute. The only thing you did was let the toilet seat up. It wasn't that big of a deal. I know.
But I agree with you. I think working out, especially.
Yeah, working out.
Some people need that.
You're too tired to really care that much, and you don't get angry.
Yeah, you know? I think everyone's different. But I do think yoga and that sort of thing, if you're into it, it does do that sort of thing, too.
Boy,
it's not for everyone.
We could spend an entire segment on this, you know, because then there's some that don't vent, but they're...
They keep it inside.
That's probably bad, too.
Horrible, yeah.
But maybe, what about, like, calmly talking about it with somebody?
I think you're not really venting. Yes.
You're not, like, getting angry. You're just saying, I feel X, Y, and Z.
That's what a therapist would tell you.
I was going to say, that's how we should handle it.
Right.
Yeah. The word is like, what's wrong? Nothing. Like, no, really, what's wrong? Nothing. And then, like, 2 days later. It's like, you know, the other day you really irritated, you know, it's like, so, it could just.
Or sometimes it just builds and builds and builds for months builds. And months and months. And then there's like an explosive something that's seemingly for something this big, but really it had to do with other issues.
If you don't like get it out a little bit somehow, you know, then you're going to feel
I think
that
my favorite thing to do is listen to, I miss being in the newsroom simply because Eric would, he wouldn't, it was just so perfectly said, and it was what we're all thinking, and he would just come in and make these grand statements, and it was just the best. I miss it. That's the only thing I miss.
The newsroom is a lot of fun because everybody's in the same room working, and then people will yell out stuff. And there's some really funny people in that newsroom. Some hilarious people.
That's why I never got my work done. I had to go sit in a corner because I was one of the yellers.
There's the writers, the angry news writers. Michael Lowe is hilarious.
He's so funny.
They're just so, you know, and so somebody will, you'll see something on a screen because the newsroom has like every single TV station known to man up there on these screens, and you're watching what's going on. Look at that. Can you believe that?
Do they ever vent? Just randomly vent? Or some a writer will be like, he totally misread my story. He ruined my story.
Sure. Well, you know what? I hate to say it. The one thing they're not watching is our show.
It's true.
Makes sense.
They're busy, you know, you got to figure out what else is happening, you know. Not that we don't love our show and we want to see what's happening. It's just that you have to keep an eye on the other things that happen.
Yeah.
Well, we do love our newsroom. We have a colorful cast of characters.
We really
do. Yeah. All right. 'Tis the season of licking. So have you ever wondered why our dogs, why they lick us? Yes, it's part of it's based on affection, of course, but there are some other reasons as well. So first, some have learned that when humans get real close to their faces, and maybe they're not comfortable with that, that they can appease the human with a lick. And then the person will pull his head away. And according to Dr. Alexandra Horowitz, a dog cognition researcher at Barnard College, the licking is an instinct that goes way back to when dogs ran in packs. If one dog was out hunting for food, when he came back to the pack, the others would lick the hunter dog's face. And that was a request that to the dog to spit up some of that food so they could eat it. So your dog might love you with a lick. Or it might just be a little hungry as well.
Maybe it needs salt too. That's another thing.
Salt.
There's like a lot of salt on your skin.
Yeah, they do.
That's why horses
like the sweat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, my horse will. And they'll lick your hand like crazy. And my horse loves salt licks that are like this big. He'll go through like in a week. But they love salt.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I think it also depends on the dog. Thankfully, mine's not a licker, and I appreciate it.
But that's interesting.
I mean, I'll deal with
it,
but I don't love it.
They don't like your face close to them.
Yeah.
And they want, they appease you.
I mean, that's
pretty
I'm faces. Yeah.
We do.
Like it or not. All right, here is our pet of the day. Check out Sasha. How beautiful is little Sasha, 1-year-old Siberian Husky. Sasha is looking for an active and adventurous family to take her on long walks and hikes. She loves carrying her toys around. She loves being loved on and enjoys just being carried around herself. Sasha is potty and crate trained, gets along really well with other dogs. She's perfect. If you're interested, contact Pet Rescue Solutions by visiting petrescuesolutions.org or just head to any of our social media accounts for a direct link to Sasha in just a few minutes. We'll be right back. It is time for Travel Tuesday, and as part of our segment today, our partners at Avelo Airlines are hooking a lucky viewer up. Holiday travel season is here, and we all know that when we travel, reliability is important. It's important for Avelo Airlines as well. For the first 10 months of the year, Avelo has had the lowest cancellation rate and ranked number one in on-time performance, according to AnaView Aviation data. Avelo features everyday low fares for convenient and reliable flights, and now is your chance to win a pair of tickets. All you gotta do is go to ktla.com/fly, ktla.com/fly, then complete and submit the form for your chance to win 2 round-trip flights on Avelo Airlines. Each round-trip ticket includes a checked bag, seat assignment up to $20, and priority boarding. Good luck.
Nice.
You know, I've traveled to Avelo. I've said it many times, but you know, they are one of our sponsors, and this is a great, obviously, promotion. It is extremely convenient to fly out of Burbank.
Yeah,
it's the best airport.
I mean, it's like now I know how people here feel about Burbank. That's how I feel about John Wayne, living in Orange County. Yeah. It's just so convenient. Yeah. I mean, LAX has obviously
a lot of options.
I mean, I get it, but if you have the choice to go to Burbank and fly a Velo because I just had a great experience.
100%.
Yeah.
And the idea that you can board from the front and the rear of the aircraft saves so much time.
So much time.
It's great.
And they're adding destinations.
They're going to get rid of it, that aspect of it eventually. You know, they want to remodel it and put it
in the airport.
Yeah, because, you know, it's a really small area. You know, you're too close to where the planes are taken off.
Burbank.
Yeah, so they
it's
they
a risk
wanna,
I'm willing to take,
yeah,
Eric.
Me too.
For the comfort.
Yeah. But apparently the folks who manage it, you know, say, okay, this is from a long time ago. We shouldn't be doing it this way. So they're going to build terminals with jetways eventually. And that will take away the charm.
Don't touch our Burbank.
I know.
Burbank.
But they've been talking about this for a long time, so hopefully
maybe not in
it'll
our
happen
lifetime.
10 or 15 years from now.
There you go.
All right, speaking of travel, have you ever dealt with lost luggage? Who hasn't? Mm-hmm. It could be one of the biggest travel nightmares, but Apple is here to help. The company has rolled out a new feature that could make it easier for passengers and airlines to retrieve lost luggage. It's meant for people who use AirTags to track their bags. The Share Item Location function will allow people to share their AirTag locations with more than 15 different airlines. You know what? This is a great idea because it will help both parties track down lost bags more efficiently. Delta, United, and British Airways are among those already using this process to track luggage. Apple says once the bag is reunited with its owner, the location tracker will be deactivated.
I don't know. Part of me is like
Big Brother-ish.
The airline putting it on us, you know?
But you choose to share it.
I use tracker. I put those in my luggage anyway, but it's just one of those where I feel like they should take the responsibility. Like, it's on me to like put the tracker in there and do that, you know, if I want my luggage back. I don't know. It's tricky.
I'm just a little confused. Okay, so I've never lost luggage. I've had luggage that didn't make a connecting flight.
Well, that's what, it's the same thing.
So it's but it's not as if the airline has ever come back and said, oh, we can't find your luggage.
Well, like, I know people, it's taken like 2 weeks and they don't know where their luggage is.
Okay, that, you know? So that's on the airlines. I get it. They got to track it down. Because I have had that happen twice. And I actually, if I have a connecting flight, I actually pray that they're going to not make my luggage. Because now it seems like every time they're like, well, you could either come back and pick it up or set up. But they usually give you like $100 travel credit.
So for something.
Me, I lost two things that I didn't need. And it was like, I got $200 credit. I'm like, yeah, go ahead. Drop it off. Give me the credit. It's fine. But I get what you're saying.
Imagine being a lady.
But you're
I know.
Girl.
I understand that. Because
and
if Lisa.
And you're traveling to Europe or something.
I get it.
Everything is
important.
Every single thing in that
That
one
was really
luggage
a silly comment.
And I, yeah.
No,
it just
I
shows
get
the
it.
Difference between I men and it. Women and how like we every little ounce and like way we pack matters. And
no, that was a silly comment. I get it. But I'm just saying it did lessen the blow when I was like, okay, I'll take the $200 credit. And it didn't feel so bad.
Already
but
done
if
with
it was
your golf clubs, that's when it happened.
Yeah.
You had already golfed with the golf clubs on the way home. Fine, lose them.
Yeah.
I got you.
So here's the thing I have about these trackers. You know, people are into buying tags or trackers and stuff. They put them in their, you know, luggage or whatever it is that's valuable. And then at some point, what if that gets stolen?
Exactly.
You know, then what do you do? Yeah. I mean, you can try calling the cops and telling them, but maybe they're not going to take it seriously. Or
not
there's
the
crazy people who will go to the location wherever it is.
I knew, you know, somebody who did that.
And that's never going to work out.
I know.
Correct.
I know.
That's not recommended.
No.
Yeah.
I know.
So what happened?
It makes us feel better. It was a house that appeared not safe, so they didn't go inside.
Good.
Yeah. It was one of those situations.
I wonder if that was something where somebody actually took it off the luggage.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yes, that happens.
Yeah, I think that does happen. You got to make sure you're there. But.
Right.
All right.
Or don't check luggage at all is my recommendation.
Oh, if you can handle that.
Yeah.
Nothing more irritating when you don't check your luggage, though, and then they're like, sorry, we're going to have to
check your luggage.
And when there's plenty of room in the overhead compartment.
Plenty of room. Or they want to charge you for it, so then you're like, I'll just carry it on.
Well, they shouldn't charge you if you have to gate check. Mm-hmm. You shouldn't have
to. They don't ever do that. You're right about that. But it's irritating because it's like, you know, why don't you just take it from the beginning?
Yeah.
Whatever. It's all the airline problems that we have, and we'll still fly anyway and still deal with it.
Yeah.
Right.
All right, what's better than a soft robotic hand working out the knots in your body? I'll be honest,
sorry.
I can think of a few others. But anyway, the Ritz-Carlton Bacara in Santa Barbara agrees, and it's adding a robotic masseuse to their spa. This cutting-edge robotic massage system is called the Escape, And the technology uses artificial intelligence to scan the body, capturing over 1.2 million 3D data points to create a custom massage. The self-service offering lets you choose options from a touchscreen, including on areas of focus, pressure, and music. It remembers your personal preferences for the next time. Massage Bot also being used at some Equinox locations and a hotel in New York City, where a 30-minute treatment is about $75. I know you talked about this earlier, Megan, but yeah. Go ahead.
No, I mean, listen, I'd give it a chance. I don't think it's that reasonably priced.
No.
I feel like you can get
a person
for cheaper and a person who does an amazing job.
And who immediately responds to whatever suggestions that you give.
Exactly.
Like this one, okay, so let's say it's pressing down too hard on your shoulder.
How do you get to the touchscreen?
Okay, but you got to get to the touchscreen and we need to readjust this. I got to reprogram this thing. I mean, that's a lot of work.
It is. And I automatically go to those massage chairs, which I'm sure it's better than those, which are fine and good enough, but it's plastic going like this does not feel the same as a human
touch.
Yeah, even if it's padded. I don't know. It's fine. I would try it, but I
for free.
I'm like,
I try it for free.
I would.
All right. We'll be right back. We have tomorrow on Off the Clock. Rich DeMuro is not only here to host, he's talking tech too. He's got the latest gadgets and gizmos for you, and you won't want to miss it.
They have given us the reveal. They don't know what they're having.
They don't know.
I've never been
so
this
excited.
Nervous on television.
This is all right.
Who's counting down?
All three, Marcus, you count us down.
One, two, three. It's a boy!
It was a sweet moment during ESPN's Monday Night Countdown as the crew assisted a pair of Ravens fans with
look
a gender
reveal. Look at the dad,
reveal.
By the way. Like, dads, no He's dad stoked. Is, like, ever more excited. That, you know, like,
for
dads are like, a boy!
Yeah.
It's a boy!
Yeah.
Thank God.
This moment wasn't planned on the show beforehand. The crew spotted the couple's sign asking to help with the reveal and decided to help.
The She's happy, too, but
that's what I thought the moment I saw.
Dads are always extra happy, I feel like.
Yeah, boy!
Yay!
Cool. All right. Speaking of Jason Kelce, who you just saw, he was at the Rams-Eagles game on Sunday, and you can see to the right there, my wife, Lynn.
Are those her white
him.
Sleeves?
Yeah.
Yeah, right there
on
the
She's handing
the
him a special Eagles necklace that was a family heirloom.
What?
For us for years. My wife.
Seriously?
From,
really?
Yes.
Wow.
It's a. She's from Philadelphia. She cares a lot about the Eagles, and so he wore it the whole day.
That's was she so bummed cool. though that she gave
she
up
didn't
the
get it back.
She is kind of bummed.
Yeah.
And so we're like, I think it came from, I don't know where, but we're going to get another one. We're going to get a replacement. Because, you know, it's like about.
So it's not just like those Mardi Gras beads that you can get
no,
at the party
store. No, it's
store
got the
something.
Eagles logo on it. It's got the, you know, the actual
Maybe
team
if he's
logo
watching, there. You could ask for it back.
No, he was so happy. She ran up and she goes, you want to wear this? He goes, yes, I want to wear this.
Aww.
And he wore it all day long.
That's amazing.
I think it's the best. It's cool though, because now you have the footage of it. So if you didn't have the footage, then you would be like, oh, but now you can see it, and he's wearing it.
Yeah.
So I think it's really cool.
Right. I mean, what's he gonna say? I mean, he played for the Eagles for years.
Right.
Like, no, I don't want to wear that.
Exactly. He's such a good guy too.
He
just
guy.
Goes along, has a good time.
Yeah. He's
Hopefully
doing some kind
back.
Of late night show too. I mean, he's doing something special. That's what he was at the Rams Eagles tailgate before the game. And he was shooting segments there, so
oh,
I think
that's
you're
awesome.
Going to see some kind of.
He's killing it right now.
He is.
Both
doing
brothers
well.
Are killing
yeah,
it.
Yeah, they are.
And
on and off the field.
Yes. Yes. Time for show and tell. What you got, Henry?
You know what? I just went to my local Pet Supply Plus store in Yorba Belinda, and I love June. June is the owner, June Webb, and just you know, we like to frequent because it's a smaller. You know, pet shop, pet supply
store. It's a neighborhood
place. Yes, a neighborhood place. And she does so much for the community. She's always doing adoption events and always donation drives. Anyway, I walked in there and she set this up, complimentary photo booth. So you can go in there with your dog or your cat or any animal and you're just welcome to sit there and take a picture. And
that's great.
I just thought, you know, what a great idea to do this at the Pet Supply Plus in Yorba Linda, as I mentioned. But again, this just came unsolicited. I took the picture because I'm like, hey, Lisa, did you see this? We should take the dogs in there. And then we were talking about show and tell. I'm like, you know what? If you're in the area and you want to maybe something cool. Yeah. People are looking for a Christmas card or whatever.
Yeah. Put it on the gram.
Take advantage of this.
I love that she's really like keeping up with the times in that way. Because you're right, Eric.
Yeah,
everyone's looking to take a picture for their Instagram and put it up. And so good for her.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yes,
very
I love
cute.
It.
Have a great day.
Wait.
Okay.
There's more.
There's
yes.
more.
Wait. There's more.
And we have time. So
okay.
here.
We, have time.
Right, we got this beginning. Shot.
Okay, all right. Yes. So this is my barbecue turkey.
Oh,
we
got
nice.
The turkey.
And the Foster's beer can, which is inserted in the turkey to create, it boils when you're cooking the turkey on the barbecue, and you drink half the beer because you don't need the full can.
Correct.
So while cooking, drink half and put the can in the turkey, and then it boils the beer, and you put some herbs in the beer there too, and that goes inside and makes it, yeah, with a regular sort of can opener.
Okay, silly question, because I know you took some of the beer out. I would imagine it boils inside of the can, nothing spills over. I mean, does any of it get in there, then you can use it to like baste? Obviously, you have the basting from the turkey itself.
Yeah. What you're doing is you're putting a sauce on it at the end, and we'll show that. But the idea is it makes it moist from the inside because the beer is boiling and gives it extra taste.
Do we see a finished product?
Yes.
Yep.
It's very dark.
Ooh, yummy. That's
it
lovely.
It is really nice.
That looks beautiful. Spillman. Yeah.
Yeah.
Nicely
and you
done.
And you use mesquite chips to give it the smoky flavor as well.
Very
and this
good.
Is this is kind of this is something you do every year.
Yes.
This is
yeah.
like was this passed down or
no,
did you just try
you
it
for
because you used to go to people's
we used
homes
to go to
all
people's
time.
Homes and they had all kinds of ways of cooking turkeys and I saw somebody do this and I'm like, okay, I'll try it. You know, there's the beer butt chicken recipe, this is a beer butt turkey recipe.
Love it.
Does
easy
a beer
to
matter?
Find online. Easy to find. What?
Does a beer matter? Your favorite beer?
I like that can, that type of beer, because the can's a little bit bigger.
Yeah.
Makes
yeah.
sense.
Makes sense.
You know, my favorite segment you did was the one family that would slap the turkey.
Yeah.
I mean,
gosh.
You ran
legendary.
Into some, oh my God, and people that would go to the beach
yes.
in the fire
yes.
pit. I mean, that was an awesome segment
right.
because it's just
we'll
great
bring
how
it back.
People.
We'll bring
yeah.
it back.
Yeah, but slapping the turkey was pretty, was pretty funny.
It was funny, but it was a little strange.
It was, of course.
That's amazing. Great.
Every member of the family, including the kids, would come back and slap this raw
slap
turkey.
The turkey.
Tenderizing
do you know what?
It.
I had some people complain that it was cruel to animals.
Oh my gosh.
It doesn't surprise
dead,
me.
Okay? I'm sorry. It's not feeling any pain.
Have a good
cruel.
Day.
Oh my gosh.
See you tomorrow.